I now request Dr. Pawan Singhal, who is the moderator for this session, and also our NES main steer, so to please start the sessions. Okay, I think there is something.
Okay, can you listen to me?
Yeah, all of us can hear, Pawan. Yeah.
Mute now.
Yeah, unmuted now.
Okay. So the Neuro-Otology and Equilibrium Society of India decided to have webinars because we are going through a tough period of this corona epidemic, rather pandemic. And we used to have two or three midterm workshops as well as conferences. And it doesn't look like we are going to have our annual conference also this year. So this idea came to the mind of our president, Dr. Narendra Suratwala, and he advised to have webinars for our younger colleagues as well as for postgraduates, because you know, vertigo is something which is always has been untouched, mostly untouched, and it has been something like unresolvable problem. For the ENT as well as medicine people, for neurologists, rehabilitationists, a lot of people like that. And so we wanted to get some insight into vertigo, the balance disorders, common balance problems. And no man can be better than Dr. Srinivas Darsala to make us understand what balance system is. He can make you understand how, by which mechanism you are standing on the earth. If you are closing your eyes, then what happens to your balance system? If you are leaning on one side or playing or doing anything, somersaulting maybe, he can tell you what is going to happen. So I'll give a brief account of Dr. Srinivas. Dr. Srinivas, he did his MBBS in 1999 from Bangalore Medical College. And then he did his MS ENT from JLN Medical College, Belgaum, in 2006. He has got many publications which has been published in national and international journals about a lot of things. Mostly his work is centered around the inner ear and balance disorders. He was an associate professor there with Ramya Medical College and Center, and he also had a senior consultant post there at BGS Global Hospital, Bangalore. Then he moved towards innovations. He moved towards research in providing cheaper alternates to Indian and other developing countries, because most of the equipments you see, they are very costly in balance, for balance testing and all. So Srinivas is the lead. He is a director in the product innovation in Cyclops, and he runs a lot of courses, and he is a dynamic balance specialist and a voracious teacher. Srinivas, all up to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pawan. Okay, you always inspire us to do great things. So now I'll go straight into the session. Core loss in vertigo and imbalance. I'll touch upon a variety of topics which are going to be necessary in the care of in the clinical care of the patients from a different perspective. And also I will deal with the underlying physiological basis of some of the common disorders. So I have a lot of time, so I thought I'll include more things. So the first thing here is, we have always been told when it comes to balance, we have always been told about three things: vision, proprioception, and vestibular sensation, to the extent of becoming tired of being heard of these things. Okay. But then I want all of us to note one particular feature of this one is that there is a hierarchy of sense for postural stability, especially standing stability. The hierarchy is this vision, proprioception, and vestibular sensation. What is the meaning of this hierarchy, and what is the clinical significance of recognizing this hierarchy? It is difficult to clinically unmask a problem in a sensation that is lower down in the hierarchy when the session higher up in the hierarchy is available to the subject. This sentence may look very, very difficult, but I will explain with an example here. So we saw an hierarchy. There is a hierarchy. The topmost is vision, next is proprioception, and next is vestibular sensation. So let's remember this order. When there is a person with proprioceptive loss and he is standing on firm ground, okay, he is standing on firm ground. If he is having proprioceptive loss, with his eyes open, he will not shake. He will start shaking only when the eyes are closed, because when the eyes are open, a sensation which is higher up in the hierarchy is still available to him, so he will not shake. Only when the higher up sensation is removed, that is the time when the next in the hierarchy problems will become manifest. Okay, that is the message here. Next is, if you have a person with vestibular loss, if he is standing on firm support versus foam, you see the difference. Okay, on the left side, you have the vestibular loss standing on firm support. Higher up in the hierarchy, the proprioception is there. So as long as that is there, the lower down in the hierarchy, the vestibular system problem cannot become manifest. Only when you remove the proprioception by making him stand on foam cushion, when you make him stand on that, remove the proprioception, only then the vestibular loss becomes manifest by him shaking. So this is the first concept that I have. So this will start becoming helpful to us immediately in clinical practice. You know, if you have to really unmask a vestibular issue, especially in the chronic state, okay, in the acute state, anybody can be seen to be showing lateral pulsions and these things. But in the chronic state, if you want to unmask it, the postural responses for vestibular imbalance, the way to do it is actually not just doing a Romberg's on firm ground, not just with eyes closed or whatever. Not firm ground. He has to be both on a foam and his eyes have to be closed. Only then it can be unmasked. Okay, that is the first concept that I wanted to tell. This is a very core principle that we need to realize. So the hierarchy is this: vision, proprioception, then is the vestibular sensation. So if you have to test vestibular sensation, you have to eliminate proprioception by making him stand on cushion and also eliminate vision. If you have to test proprioception, you have to eliminate vision. It's like that. Okay. Ex-afference versus re-afference. This is another concept that I want to tell you. So you have two pictures here. There is one picture on the left of somebody who is doing a gymnastic like maneuver, which is actually a high jump. And then there is another person who has actually slipped and fallen. When you look at both of them, it is a fall backwards. So now there is a question that we need to ask ourselves. On the left, the lady who is jumping backwards, and on the right, the person who is falling backwards, what is the difference in the vestibular sensation that the inner ear sent to the brain? When you look at what is the difference to the vestibular sensation that the inner ears actually send to the brain, you will see, is there any difference? As far as the peripheral sensation sending the signal to the brain is concerned, there is absolutely no difference between a person who is voluntarily taking a jump backwards versus a person who is being pushed or slips and falls backwards. Now, how should the brain respond to one thing versus the other thing? the brain should respond to the lady who is voluntarily falling by allowing her to do what she is doing. Whereas for the person who is slipping and falling, the brain should actually activate postural corrective responses, see that he is trying to hold the plate straight now, and then probably he'll come up with a mechanism where he will take the hand backwards and he will make sure that he will land on his hand or something, or if possible in a stage to actually avoid the fall. So what determines what is the response that she is going to have there, that lady there who is voluntarily making that maneuver, and the person who is slipped, when the vestibular signal is the same. So the difference here is the difference between exafferents versus reafferents. When you are on your own stepping sideways versus when somebody has pushed you sideways, the difference here is when the brain sends, makes a motor program and sends it down for the body to perform that particular motor program, like in the gymnast on one side, that motor program, a copy of that program, that nerve signal reaches the sensory system also, and the sensory and tells the, what is expected, the signal that is expected from the vestibular system is so and so for this particular falling backwards. As long as it matches, there is nothing to be worried about. When it doesn't match, it means it is a fall. So in this particular person, when he is slips and falls, there is no motor program that has started from his brain to tell you have to fall backwards. So in the brainstem, in the vestibular nuclei, when there is a, there is nothing to match it against. So this is exafferents. This is a signal which is coming not out of his will or his act, the something that he generated, but that is something coming from external perturbations. So this is more dangerous. Whereas for the other lady, it is her plan. She wanted to fall backwards or whatever that maneuver. So that postural, whatever action she is doing, should be allowed. So this differentiation between exafferents and reafferents is very, very important. Also, when patients come to us, this concept becomes very important, because when somebody goes in the merry-go-round and they get a particular sensation, whereas when a person has a vestibular neuritis and he also gets the particular sensation, the merry-go-round person does not feel like he is suffering, whereas the vertigo person for the same sensation feels suffering. Again, the difference is that there, that is, he knows that he is undergoing that. There is a expectation, sensory expectation, what pattern of sensation is expected, the brainstem neurons know that when those things match, there is not going to be alarm signaling. Whereas when it comes to exafferents, there is going to be alarm signaling, where it is not going to be matched with the expected input that needs to come. So this is the other concept. So we have covered two important core concepts. One was the hierarchy of senses for posture. Next is the difference between exafferents versus reafferents. There are also can be some diseases where when the person does not know to differentiate between this exer and reafferents, they may spontaneously have falls. There are some kinds of astasias where though they are falling, they don't make the postural correction, and all the tests that we do for their sensation is comes out normal, but you find that this person comes with repeated falls. And everything comes to be normal because he is not able to differentiate between reafferents versus exafferents, and his actual exafferent falls is not able to correct because he may be looking at them. Okay, so that could be one of the reasons. Okay, that signaling of exafferents as a danger may not be present in them. Peripheral and central mechanisms, what is the purpose? All of the time we keep thinking, we keep deciding, okay, we keep discussing what is peripheral vestibular disorder, what is central vestibular disorder. Okay, now if both peripheral and central were doing the same work, what was the need for two different things? Now I'll tell what is the difference between peripheral and central mechanisms. The main role of peripheral vestibular system is to detect head perturbations, head movements, head orientation. That's all. If the head is moving, if the head is stable, if the head is tilted, whatever it is, it has to detect. I request you, if you are seeing only the screen, to just shift from only the screen to start seeing my video also. Okay. So make sure that you now at this particular point of time, look at my video also. The main function of the central vestibular system, of so many things it does, is something called reference frame transposition. Now I hope all of you are able to look at my video. Okay, if something is there, you can let, if there is a difficulty, you can put it in the chat box, so I'll be told. Okay, now look at me. If my head goes like this, what do you see? What do you interpret that as? That means that I am going to fall backwards. That means that I am going to fall backwards. I will show you something else now. Okay, I will just take off the video for 1 minute and then I will come back to that. Okay. Okay, you know what I am trying to do. Now you can see my video. Now, if my head goes back like this, what is the interpretation? If you only look at my head, the interpretation is that I am actually falling backwards. Is that right? But then, if you notice, if you see my body, now you know this actually meant not falling backwards, but falling towards my right. Did you notice the difference? So, if you are looking at only the head and try to decide, this movement is, could be anything. It could be falling backwards or it could be falling sidewards. Without looking at the body, without looking at the head's position over the neck, you can't decide whether the person is falling backwards or whether the person is falling sidewards. What does the vestibular system signal? The vestibular system itself cannot signal anything about the body. It signals only about the head. So, depending on the other things, neck input and other inputs, visual input and all those things, there needs to be something called a reference frame transposition from the head to the entire body reference so that the postural response is also appropriate. If I'm falling backwards, the postural response is to correct towards coming forwards. Whereas if I was actually for the same vestibular response, the head is telling the same thing, but for the same kind of response, if the body is actually falling to the right, the correct response is falling to the right. This kind of multiple kinds of reference frame transposition is what these central mechanisms do. In addition to, there are other things, but this is one principal thing that the central mechanisms do, from the eye reference frame to the head reference frame, from the head reference frame to the body reference frame, from the body reference frame to the earth reference frame. Different kinds of transpositions happen for different purposes. That is what is the purpose of these central mechanisms. Especially if you see a person who's had an acute vestibular neuritis, if his fastigial nucleus is working very well, if his fastigial, especially the caudal fastigial nucleus, is working very well, there is no problem in this particular head to body reference frame transposition based on neck input. There is absolutely no problem. So what will happen if you see a person with acute vestibular neuritis? If you make him stand like this, if the right vestibular, there is a right vestibular loss neuritis, so the left will try to push him to the right. So when you look at him like this, he's going to show this lateropulsion. So there is a vestibular imbalance because of disease, pure vestibular disease. Because of this, he is being pushed to the back. Because his caudal vestibular nucleus is nice, so what will happen is, even if you make the person turn to one side like this, now this imbalance is transposed to the body correctly without any problem. And now, when in this position, if he is falling to this one, in this position, he will start falling forwards. The transposition happens because the central mechanisms are good, especially the caudal fastigial nucleus. So, peripheral versus central, and the transposition of reference frames was one more concept that I wanted to convey, and I think that is conveyed. So, we have seen the hierarchy of senses for posture. The next thing that we saw was related to exafferents versus reafferents, and then now we saw the peripheral and central mechanisms. What is the purpose and how do they do? Okay. Next, the next core concept that I wanted to convey here is neurotransmitters involved in the vestibular signaling and processing. Okay, it looks like very big, but there is a purpose why I have chosen this into the core concept, not into some depth or whatever it is in the beginning itself. When you look at the vestibular nuclei nucleus here, you can see the number of neurotransmitters. There is glutamate, glycine, glutamate, GABA, acetylcholine. GABA coming from the cerebellum. Then there is histamine coming from the tuberomammillary nucleus. Then there are from the other side commissural nucleus. Then there are 5-hydroxytryptamine, noradrenaline, dopamine, and then there are several peptides that like enkephalin, substance P, and all those things. So many chemicals you see here. The idea of including this particular thing is it is all about chemicals, and there are multiple types of chemicals, I mean neurotransmitters, that are taking part in the control or in the processing of vestibular function. There is acetylcholine, there is histamine, there is glycine, there is GABA, and all those things. And of course, noradrenaline, dopamine, and all this. 5-hydroxytryptamine. Then there are neuropeptides. Why am I trying to tell? What am I trying to convey? When you look at so many drugs that are available, and there are different kinds of neurotransmitters and synaptic mechanisms that are available, when clinically you see there is a response, when clinically you see that this particular combination is working, don't be swayed by that thinking, oh, one is histamine, one is antihistamine, how can they work? That kind of arguments, don't fall for them, because the synapses are different. It can be histamine, there can be antihistamine, or whatever it is. Clinically, if you are seeing a response, believe your clinical response that you are noting, and start trying different combinations of medicines, and start noting. Don't be apologetic about usage of medications, especially when they are working. Okay, that I am not here talking about what it does to the compensation and all those things. That is another topic. But what I'm telling, if you see a clinical response, if you are seeing a clinical, if it is for a short duration or whatever, if you are seeing clinical response with a certain combination, don't fall for certain arguments and become afraid that I don't. There are so many different types. So there is a role for things like a GABA inhibitors. There is a role for acetylcholine type of arguments. There is histamine thing. And even dopamine for that matter is present time. Okay. Feeling of guilt that I'm using the medicine. Somebody told me that medicines are bad, medicines are wrong, medicines are unethical. Give up that kind of a guilt and start openly discussing, start sharing your ideas about your medicine combinations or single medicines or medicine combination which have been working for you, so that the entire world knows what is working in that particular patient, so that we can actually proceed. Okay, so that eventually we give something to the world. That is the next concept. Okay, the neurotransmitters involved in the vestibular system. The next thing, the next core concept that I wanted to tell, I will go to the basics also. Okay, don't worry. Okay, but there are some core concepts which I wanted to convey in, and then go to that. Properties of neuro individual neurons. Resting, discharge, and pacemaker-like activity. So when you look at the vestibular system, especially the vestibular nuclei and the neurons in the vestibular nuclei, they always have something called a resting discharge. So whether the periphery fires or it does not fire, okay, whether the inner ear is giving signal or not giving signal, they have their own resting discharge activity. And even if all the inputs are cut off to the vestibular nucleus, when all inputs are cut off also, in some time, it gains a pacemaker-like activity, which it starts spontaneously firing. And this kind of recovery of spontaneous firing and spontaneous pacemaker activity in the vestibular nucleus is very, very important for regaining of static balance. I mean, not the dynamic one, the static balance. Even some kind of relearning happens on this dynamic, that's a different issue. But regaining of static balance is because of this. One of the factors which leads to that is this pacemaker-like activity, just like the heart pacemaker. This also, on its own, it can start firing. That is the feature of this particular thing called... the pacemaker activity of the neurons. Next core concept that I wanted to convey here is about the cupular diaphragm. So we see a variety of pictures of the cupula being represented in different textbooks. I get questions from postgraduate students like, this book writes like this book writes like this, what I'm supposed to? So I've taken an actual study of something that has been done many, many decades ago, where the Alcyon blue was injected on one particular, this is the semicircular canal, this is the ampullary part. And when they put the dye on one side, the dye actually comes and stops at the cupula. So the cupula is actually a diaphragm. The cupula is actually a diaphragm. What is the significance? Why should we know that the cupula is a diaphragm? So if on the other side also the Alcyon blue has to come, they had to inject onto the vestibular side or the utricular side only then, so that they could actually demonstrate this particular cupular diaphragm. I hope all of you can see my arrow here, the pointer arrow. So you can see this as the cupular diaphragm. So you can see the semicircular canal, you can see the ampulla, the Alcyon blue stops at the cupular diaphragm. What is the immediate clinical significance of this? The immediate clinical significance of this is, if there is a debris somewhere here, it cannot be pushed into the utricle across the cupular diaphragm. This debris has to go all around. So when you are actually planning a maneuver, you can't plan a maneuver where you can just make it push to this side. The maneuver has to ensure that this debris, whichever is here, if at all it is there, it has to go all around and then enter. The other thing also is, when you actually are worried about, after doing positional maneuvers, all of us have a fear that the person can have this particular fear that there is going to be re-entry into another canal and cause a new problem. So when you look at that, the end, if a debris has to enter this canal and actually reach this area, it has to enter from the back side only. So when you see the location of these canals, okay, this open end is on the other side, or is on the back side. Even for the common crust, it is on the top and the back. For the horizontal canal, again, it is in the back. So a simple act of, after positioning, making the head little bent downwards is enough to ensure that that debris will not slip backwards. So this is the clinical significance of this, knowing this cupular diaphragm. Because from the front, even if it goes, it can go only up to here and it will come and fall back. Very rarely it goes and stays there. So this is the importance of knowing this. So next concept is, okay, and then this is another study which, out of interest, I just picked up and showed. So how does the cupular diaphragm bend? They injected oil droplets from one end at different levels, and then when the oil droplets are being bent to one particular direction, further proving that it is a cupular diaphragm. Then the other physiological significance of this one is, we are generally used to feeling, that is acutely she was telling. The when you have vertigo, the fluid inside starts rolling and rolling inside the inner ear. Actually, that is very nice, dramatic, very cute to hear, but it is that fluids don't actually go whirling inside. When you bend like this, the fluid tends to push this side, but doesn't actually move it, because the cupular diaphragm is strained and the cupular diaphragm is pulled, pushed to one particular side, okay, with the tension. There is a tension on that, okay, but there is no actual fluid moving round and round. So when you are going round and round to the right, the fluid is not actually going on moving round and round to the left. It just presses on the cupular diaphragm, deflects it to the opposite side. Then the next concept that I wanted to tell you is, we have a question. I'll come to the basics also. Okay, please pardon me. But tonic versus phasic responses, we all know in our physiology classes, we know the difference between gastrocnemius and soleus. One is tonic, one is phasic, and all those things. So we need to revisit that in the inner ear also. When you look at the inner ear, we are always told there is a type 2 hair cell, there is a type 1 hair cell, and then what is the, why are there two type different types of hair cell? What is the function of type 1 and what is the type of type 2? The prototypical hair cell which we all the time we study is the type 2 hair cell, which is constantly discharging in a very, very regular fashion, and it is very easy to understand. But there is one more hair cell, the type 1 hair cell. Type 2 is generally considered as a regular fibers. It is connected to what is called as regular fibers, and type 1 hair cell is connected to something called irregular fibers generally. What happens is the type 2 hair cells, which are regular, this thing, there is a constant, or there is a very tonic stimulation. There is always a nerve fiber activity which is happening, and if you start rotating on to the right, if you increase the velocity or whatever, depending on with what velocity you are rotating, according to that, it will tune its response. So if it for one velocity of rotation, it is sending signals at 100 spikes per second, for another velocity, 150, for another velocity, 200 or whatever. But its timing is not that great. It cannot tell when you started the sudden head movement. That comes from this phasic responses, and that phasic response to give the precise timing signal. So this one is coming from the type 1 hair cell, where which will tell it just happened this particular point of time in the from the irregular fibers. They are going to tell you the precise timing signal based on which the other systems know this is the when this started. The other one will tell with what velocity it is happening, but cannot tell what particular point in time this actually began. That timing signal, and that is very, very important for planning a lot of reflex responses, and that is why the irregular fibers, which once in a while fire when suddenly something happens, is very, very important. So this was okay, something for people who have actually listened to my previous things and already are aware of all the physiological concepts of how the hair cell filing happens and all those things, this kind of introduction, which is going to help you in the clinical practice. Now, the next one that I'm going to talk to you, okay, I hope I still have time, okay, okay, is that is the actual core physiological mechanisms. Okay, I will do that now. Then I will do the physiological mechanisms as it relates to the disease conditions. If there is anything that I need to change or something, please let me know. Okay, I am proceeding thinking that everything is running smoothly, because I don't know what is happening on the other end. Okay. The key to understand what exactly is happening at the molecular level or whatever in the inner ear is to understand the hair cells. From understanding the hair cell, after that, I will take you into the three groups of disorders with a physiological basis. So let us go on the hair cells. Now, this is the prototypical hair cell, the type 2 one, which is being depicted here. On one side is the actual electron microscope picture. So what you see here is there is one tall thing which is called the kinocelium, and there is a hierarchy, there is according to height arrangement of projections which are called as stereocilium. When you expand one particular area and then see here, what happens is that you can see small rope like projections going from one hair to the other hair. One rope like projections going from one hair to the other hair. So I hope you can all see in this particular picture. Fine. So if you see this in a diagrammatic representation here, there is the kinocelium and there are tiplings coming from one to the other, one to the other, one to the other, one to the other. What is the purpose of this particular arrangement is what we are supposed to see. So what we will do, we will just project into one of these tiplings and the stereocilia, go close and see what is happening. So when you go deep into that particular thing, the tiplink, when you saw, the tiplink is made up of these two proteins, the catherine and protocatherine. This is the one that makes that particular rope. And when you see here, what happens to this particular rope is that it, one end of it is into the senior stereocilia, and this one is to the next one stereocilia to a channel complex. So it gets attached to a channel complex, which means if this particular stereocilia moves in one particular direction, this channel, the extent to which this channel is open or closed is going to be determined with how much this is pulling. So if this one pulls, this channel opens up, there is a gap that is created here, which means the potassium ions that are there in the endolymph can actually easily start entering. So this is what is going to happen. So now I'll go back to the previous image and show. So when the kinocelium is like this, and the kinocelium starts pulling to my right, okay, pulling in this particular direction, it pulls on these tiplings, which is the catherine. And when it pulls on those tiplings, it will open up the channel and allow potassium to enter. When it allows potassium to enter, there are a set of changes that happen within the hair cell. There is something that changes the basolateral currents here. There is going to be entry of other ions. Then there is going to be degranulation of vesicles. Degranulation of vesicles lead to the neurotransmitters entering the synaptic cleft. And thus neurotransmitter is going to set up an action potential in the nerve fiber. So this is what this is. We'll go back to this particular thing. So what will happen is, at rest, when all the stereocilia are straight and doing nothing, even at that time, this particular channel is open. So even at that time, it is partially open. When this is relaxed by going in this direction, it will collapse to closure. And when this moves in this direction, this will open up. So this is a very beautiful concept. This, because of this, even a hair cell which is completely at rest is sending some signals. Even a hair cell which is completely at rest is able to send signals, is continuously sending signals. So this will ensure that there is, because the signal is already there. So now I want to now take the example. Why should the signal already be there? Why did the body, the physiology decide to keep the channel partially open and always send, keep sending some action potentials even when the head is not moving? What is the advantage that this gives to the system? The advantage this gives to the system is, I will want you to now think about you driving a car. And the car has not yet started. When the car has not yet started and you start pressing on the accelerator of the car, can a person looking at you or feel sitting in the car, can he make out how much you are pressing even when the car has not yet started? There is some amount of pressing you do when till which time the car does not start going forwards. Only afterwards it starts moving forward. So some amount of pressing cannot be detected by the person who is sitting next to you. Whereas if the car is already on the highway and you are driving, at that time you make a small change on the accelerator, the other person can make out. Which means when the movement is already happening, small changes in the movement of the accelerator can be made out. Whereas when it is not yet started, it is difficult. Same thing here. If the channel which is closed, has to be opened up, then there would be some amount of deflection that is wasted, which cannot be detected. After that only it can be detected. Whereas if the channel is already open, and already conducting, then small changes here will lead to opening, small changes into this side will lead to closing, and therefore it gives a certain kind of dynamic detection capabilities which would not otherwise be there if it had to be open. If it was already closed, up to some tension, it is still not going to open. Only when it crosses the threshold of tension, it will open. Till that one, whatever movement caused, that much tension would have got wasted, but now it is not going to be. That is the reason why nature chose this kind of a mechanism. Now, this is the hair cell. What is this hair cell doing? We all know now, it is only doing detection of movement, this deflection. Now, this same hair cell, look at this beauty, stop, ponder for a minute and see. This is one hair cell. What is this hair cell? This hair cell is a mechanoreceptor. That's all. It detects changes, movement, okay, on its kinocilium or whatever it is, the hair cell deflection it detects. Now, this detection, deflection has to be changed and made into something more robust for different purposes. Okay, you use the same fan at home. If you run the fan in one way, it becomes a fan. If it is in the hall, it becomes a fan. It is in the toilet, it becomes, you turn it the other way, it becomes an exhaust fan. So it is the same one which serves different purposes. So similarly, here, the same hair cell, which is able to detect small changes in its stereociliary orientation, you place it in different areas, it starts showing different functions. What are those? You take it into the, so if you place it on the basilar membrane, the same hair cell, and the basilar membrane's deflections happen in response to sound, and you have the basilar membrane being arranged in a particular tonotopic arrangement, and there the hair cell becomes a detector of sound. Now take the same hair cell and place it in the semicircular canal, this same hair cell becomes a detector of, in the semicircular canal, there is rotation, and then because of the rotation, there is a deflection, and because of that, in the semicircular canal, it becomes a detector of angular rotation. You place it in the otolith organ, it becomes a detector of gravity. I will come to the details of that, but before that, something more about the semicircular canal. We saw in the semicircular canal that kinocilia moving in this direction causes opening, kinocilia moving in this direction causes closing of that particular channel, and show there is an action potential change. So we saw that here. Now, when you actually see in detail, so kinocilium will be somewhere on this particular side, and the keen, okay, if this was, so if the kinocilium moves in this along this line arrow, there is going to be increased tension in the tip links over here, and which are attached to the ion channels, and which will cause opening and closing of the ion master plane. This does not lead to closing and opening of the ion channels, which means the hair cell by its own construction has a beautiful property. That property is that there is a directional preference of the hair cell by its construction itself. So if it moves in this direction, it cannot. How do we use that? look at the sacula, look at the utricle. Now, when you look at the sacula and utricle, you know about the hair cell arrangement across this triola and how the triola runs in different places. So, if you see here in the sacculus or in the utriculus, you know that the hair cell, they shows there is a certain arrangement where all the kinocilium are in one particular direction. Here, as it goes, they start, the arrangement keeps changing along the sacculus. So, if you go by this particular principle where this is not going to be activated in this direction, but activated in this particular direction, if you see this, look at the sacculus here. So, in this direction, movement will lead to opening and closing of the channels here in this region. And this particular movement in this particular plane is going to lead to opening and closing of channels here, which means when for a particular, if the head is moving in this plane, if these hair cells are getting excited and inhibited in this particular region, they are not getting excited and inhibited in this particular region, because for this it is along the plane of the kinocilium. Here it is right angles to the plane of the kinocilium, and therefore there is not going to be change, which means there is a map here. If the hair cells are getting excited, it means that the person is moving in this plane. If the hair cell are getting excited, the person is moving in another plane. That is how this mapping of which direction the person is moving is done by the inner ear. So, what happens? What is this that I am holding here, and how this becomes a sensor of gravity? This particular hair cell, we know in the this hair cell, when it was placed in the cochlea, was a detector of sound because the basilar membrane vibrated in response to sound. Now, how does this particular sacculus and utricle become a detector of gravity is the question. So we know this is the simple Mason's plumb bob. So Mason's plumb bob, what he uses to find the line of gravity, the verticality, is he uses something heavy which hangs on a string, which is pliable string, so that it is, that string is held vertical. If the string is held vertical, it means that is corresponding to the line of gravity. Now, so if you want the inner ear to become a detector of gravity, you need to take this plumb bob into the inner ear. What is this plumb bob? Plumb bob is nothing but something heavy. So, in the inner ear, what has happened? Nature has chosen to put stones, which are called as lith or statoconia. Lith means stone. Lith in the inner ear is otolith. So, they have placed those stones there, and those stones sag in the direction of the head tilt towards one particular direction. That they sag in one particular direction, all of these things en masse sag in one particular direction. But we know, depending on the direction, if you map this to this, you will know so easily, depending on each direction of my head tilt, a different area is going to get stimulated or inhibited, and another area is going to remain immune to that action. It is not going to be getting stimulated or inhibited. So, based on which area is getting stimulated, the brain can easily map the plane in which I tilted was in this particular plane. So, this is about the statoconia. Now, this same hair cell, we saw that same hair cell was the one which was detecting sound. The same hair cell is the one which is now detecting gravity. Now the same hair cell has to now supposed to want, we want it to detect rotations of the head. So how do you make that same hair cell detect rotations of the head, and see how nature has chosen this beauty called the semicircular canal? If this hair cell was in a plane, open ground, it was doing nothing, and then it is responsive to all kinds of movements, all kinds of stimulation. Wherever you do, it would shake, but by its own intrinsic property, it would become a detector of only linear acceleration, because the other side, it doesn't lead to opening and closing of the channels. This one opens, but then it is susceptible to movement, but it is detector of linear acceleration in only one direction by its own intrinsic property of that kinoscelium directional property. But how do you make this a detector of a rotational acceleration? Simple. Place this at the end of a semicircular tube. When you place something in the center of a tube, if it was it's a bigger ball versus a tube, the difference is in a bigger ball or open place, whatever, if you move, the fluid or the forces act in all directions. Whereas in a pipe, when you move up and down, the forces cannot act, okay, cannot cause a fluid shift, okay, fluid shift or a fluid tension in one particular direction. If it is up and down, there is not much of a net action. The walls are going to stop it immediately. Whereas if you turn in this particular direction along the plane of the pipe, then that is going to lead to a rotational tension that is going to be built up. Some kind of a fluid's tendency to move in one particular direction, though the fluid doesn't actually move much other than deflecting the cupola in one particular direction. So the directional property, and this is only in response to rotation, not to movements. So if this particular thing is going to move in one plane, okay, like this, if this particular semicircular canal or a circular canal moves up and down or moves at right angles to this, like this, there is not much. Okay, if you turn it this way, there is not much of fluid movement. Whereas if you turn like this, then there is going to be movement, okay, of fluid is within this. It's not actually movement, that's a force generated. So there is going to be along this. So that is what makes this particular semicircular canal converts something that was a linear sensation of linear motion in this plane to a sensor of circular motion, because here the fluid tension only builds up because of circular movement of the semicircular canal. Okay, and each semicircular canal is in a particular plane, and the optimal direction is that particular plane. Therefore, there are three semicircular canals to ensure that all three planes are detected, X, Y, and Z, and anything in between by mathematical function which happens in the inner ear. So this is about the hair cell. Okay. Now coming to some of these diseases, some of the common diseases. When you deal with peripheral vestibular disorders, there are three common patterns of diseases that all of us should always remember. One is aberrant stimulations. Next is bilateral vestibular failure. And the third one is unilateral vestibular failure. These are the three things according to which most peripheral vestibular conditions fit in. What is aberrant stimulation? Aberrant stimulation or inhibition is when the inner ear is stimulated by a non-vestibular signal. So the semicircular canal, by now we all know, the semicircular canal has to be stimulated by what? It has to be stimulated by rotation of the head. That is how it is. The brain, the wiring in the brain from since birth or whatever, even before birth, has happened in such a way that semicircular canal signaling simply means that the head has been rotating. Just imagine a condition where the protective wall of the semicircular canal is removed and it is no longer there. So the protective wall of the semicircular canal is not there. So it is exposed to the intracranial content. Now intracranial pressure changes get transmitted to the semicircular canal. So this particular person, when he tries to lift a weight or something, what happens is this change in the intracranial cavity gets transmitted into the semicircular canal, and that will lead to the cupular stimulation. If that leads to the cupular deflection, that leads to the stimulation of that particular semicircular canal, and that will lead to signaling that reaches the brain. Just give me 1 minute. Okay, so what is going to happen now is that when there is going to be a change in intracranial pressure, like straining, lifting weights or whatever, that change is going to be transmitted here. There is going to be. But the brain does not know that this is because of lifting weight, because brain has always been used to this particular semicircular canal getting stimulated for rotations along this particular plane. And now it is coming from an aberrant generation. The signal is coming from an aberrant source, but the brain does not know. Because it is coming from the semicircular canal, brain thinks it is rotation signal. And then it interprets it that way. And therefore, you get a sensation of rotation. And therefore, the person also feels that. And then in response to that, there is going to be some amount of eye movement, which is a corrective eye movement. So this is one aberrant. The other kind of aberrant signaling which happens is, I'll just come back to that. The other kind of aberrant signaling that happens is, we now know that the utricle and saccule are gravity sensors and the semicircular canals are rotation sensors. Sometimes because of degeneration of the utricle, this is the utricular diagram with the grains of sand or whatever, otolith or organs or whatever. So when these become loose from here, from the utricle, those loose particles leave the utricle, come and settle in one of the semicircular canals. So they enter and then they come and settle in one of the semicircular canals. When these things come and settle in the semicircular canals, the movement was happening only with response to angular accelerations, because the semicircular canal does not have anything heavy. It was not responding to gravity. Now, this particular thing, when because of disease, the debris comes and sits in the semicircular canal. When it comes and sits in the semicircular canal, in a standing person, it comes and occupies the most dependent post, the lowest part with respect to gravity. It comes and sits here. When the person goes and lies back, this one moves from here and goes to the new, because if he is lying down, this is the new lowest part, and it starts moving from one place and goes and settles in the new place. As it moves from one place to the other place along, it starts a fluid negative pressure, suction kind of pressure, which causes the cupula to deflect in the direction of movement of this one. Cupular deflection now is happening. The person was sitting, he just went and lied down. After he lied down, this started moving. It continued for around 30 seconds or 40 seconds, 50 seconds, depending on each person's load. So as it happens, goes on moving, and the cupula is deflected. He's actually gone and lied down. That's all. He's no longer moving. But the fluid continues to show that strain. The cupula continues to be deflected. And the brain does not know that this is happening in response to gravity. The brain thinks all the time semicircular canal signaling means rotation. From the time I was born, even before I was born, when I was in the mother's womb also, semicircular canal stimulation meant rotation. So this gravity related movement from one place to other place is actually interpreted by the brain as something else, interpreted by the brain as continuing ongoing rotation, and that is why you get a sensation of vertigo in benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. We have seen two kinds of aberrant stimulation here. There is another, both of them related to semicircular canals. One of them is dehiscences, and other is the benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. There's another kind of aberrant stimulation that can happen in the utricle and saccule, where the direction verticality suddenly is shown in another direction. Most commonly is seen when after BPPV positioning maneuver, the debris goes and comes and then falls from the common crust into the utricle. Suddenly the utricle is stimulated, and that particular time what is going to happen is, in some cases, some of us have actually noticed it in our practice, other people, there are only two groups of vestibular practitioners, one of whom has already faced this and another person who is going to face this. What is going to happen is, so there is nobody who is not going to see this. Okay, so we have already seen, or we are going to see. So when this, after the positional maneuver, when this debris goes and falls on the utricle, there is an aberrant signaling from the utricle. The utricle suddenly starts telling, this is not the line of verticality. This is the line of verticality. And the person generates a postural response, and he tends to go and fall in one particular direction. If that happens, it is good news, because because the person, you have actually repositioned the particles back. Okay, your repositioning maneuver is correct. All that you need to tell to the person is reassurance. And other kinds of stimulation, that kind of things also can happen, which can lead to Tumarkin's kinds of drop attacks, which can happen in mini arrays disease. Tumarkin's kind of drop attacks can happen before the BPPV in some individuals when this can slip off. Okay, when some degenerates and then suddenly slips off and comes off, at that particular moment, the person can fall. So there are a variety of mechanisms because of which it can happen. So this is this is one group of conditions called aberrant stimulation. The next group of conditions that I want to deal with as of now is a group of conditions called unilateral vestibular, bilateral vestibular failure. And then I am going to deal with a condition called unilateral vestibular failure. And then with that information, you will know everything that needs to be known in everything that needs to be known when it comes to as far as the peripheral vestibular system is concerned, the physiological concept based on which you need to know this thing. So before I go to these two things, we need to go a little more deep into something. What are the functions of the vestibular system? So we all the time we are used to telling function, vestibular system balance, vestibular system balance. That is it. We have been used to that. Okay. But when you talk about the vestibular system and about it as a sense, okay, we need to now go into, if you have to resolve a problem, we need to go into the specifics. What are the specifics of the vestibular system? Then you will talk about three different functions. One function of the vestibular system is stable vision. Another function is postural stability. And the third function is it works as the body's internal global positioning system. Okay. Internal global positioning system. I'll deal with the last one. Internal global positioning system. What do I mean by internal global positioning system? When you are sleeping in a large cot, big cot, tonight you sleep at your home. You sleep on one end, tomorrow morning you see that you have actually woken up from the other end. You are rolling and rolling and no. On another day when you are traveling by train, there is a small narrow berth that is given to you and you are going to sleep on that particular berth. It is so narrow, every day you are sleeping, you are used to rolling on bed. There is a fear that I am used to rolling on bed. Here this is so narrow, I may fall off. You will not fall. You will not fall. Because our brains can map the environment and remember it even during our sleep. And the basis for this is the vestibular system, which maps the environment. That is one of the functions. Then also for navigation, in the sense pathfinding and all these things, spatial orientation. So pathfinding, for all these things, vestibular system is very important. I'll not go into the detailed hippocampal mechanisms for this. But when it comes to postural stability, the main thing that is important for maintaining upright posture is detection of line of gravity. So therefore, when it comes to postural stability, the primary vestibular system that is responsible for postural stability is the utricle and saccule, which are the graviceptors. And the other thing is, when I'm turning, when I'm moving around, moving my head right, left, up, down, whatever it is, still I'm able to look correctly, because when I move my head to the right, the eye moves to the left. When I move my head to the left, eye moves to the right. This one is through the semicircular canals, which detect the head rotation or angular acceleration, make a correction of the eye. So there are three functions that are there: vision-related functions, postural stability-related functions, and global body's internal GPS, spatial orientation, and pathfinding. What will happen to a particular person who has had a bilateral vestibular failure? What happens to a person who has had a bilateral vestibular failure? Okay. So when somebody has a bilateral vestibular failure, what happens to him is that all these three functions, okay, of stable vision, postural stability, and also pathfinding and spatial orientation are lost. So they have that vague sensation of dizziness, which they cannot explain, which is actually spatial disorientation. And they have postural instability, so they cannot, especially in ground which is not good and eyes are closed or in dark, they cannot find their place. So they keep shaky, they have an imbalance. The third one is they cannot stabilize their vision. They cannot stabilize their vision. They cannot stabilize their vision in response to when the head is moving. So when the head is moving to the right, the eye has to move to the left so that they can still focus on an object. But because they have bilateral vestibular failure, they cannot do it. So they have a problem of deteriorating vision during the movement. When they are moving, they cannot see clearly. But when they are stable and they can hold the head, then they can see clearly. So these are the problems. So they will have difficulty in vision when they are moving. They will have postural instability and they have a vague sense of perception. This is the one. Okay. Can I know how much more time I am left with? Because based on, I think I'm almost there. So I'll just do one more thing. I'll not get into the other loss because we are running short of time and we need to do the discussion also. Okay. So what happens when a person has a unilateral labyrinthine failure? So that is one more thing that we need to detect. So what we saw here is the hair cells are firing even in neutral position is what we saw. We know this. Okay. So now is the time for us to go into little depth. In 5 minutes, I will finish this. Okay. So what will happen to a person? All these things I'm just reviewing. Okay. Unilateral labyrinthine failure. So what will happen is right side and left side hair cells are firing even when the head is not moving. And the canal pairs are arranged in a push-pull configuration. Right side and left side, they are arranged in a push and pull configuration. A head movement that causes excitation of one canal causes inhibition of its partner in the pair. So let us imagine this one. So there is the right side horizontal canal and left side horizontal canal. The kinocelium, if it is medial, this will be towards one side, this will be to the opposite side. If there is a rightward head rotation, both of these kinocelia, this kinocelia moves to the left, this kinocelia also moves to the left. But when you remember the diagram of the hair cell, this kinoceliary movement is going to cause what is called as excitation. This is going to cause what is called as inhibition. What is the difference between resting state and this state is, in the resting state, see, there are 60 action potentials and 60 action potentials coming from either side. Both of them converge on the vestibular nuclei in the brainstem. They cancel out. Detailed mechanism of cancel out, I'm not explaining, but then they cancel out because of synaptic interactions. And the person feels that he is now stable. Whereas when there is a rightward head rotation, there is going to be increase in action potentials on the right side and decrease in the number of action potentials from the left side. When they meet in the brainstem, there is not much of canceling. This override, the right side signals override the signals that is coming from the left side. And that leads to the impression that the person, that leads to the sensation that the person is moving to the right side. And that leads to the eyes moving to the left side. When the head rotates to the right, eyes move to the left side based on this net, the difference in input. So the brain works not as an enumerator. It doesn't actually count it. It is a comparator. It compares what is coming from the right, what is coming from the left. So if what is coming from the right exceeds what is coming from the left, you are moving to the right. If what is coming from the left exceeds what is coming from the right, it means you are moving to the left. This is how brain is. So it works like a comparator. So a single canal can move detection in both sides, but inhibition saturates all those things. What will happen when one canal stops working? This is the typical thing that happens. But more permanently, it happens in vestibular neuritis, labyrinthitis. But once in a while, it comes and goes. Okay, in a temporary for some time, it happens in Meniere's disease and that kind of problem. What happens here is, if one canal stops working, before their 60 hertz from this side and 60 hertz and this side, they were canceling out and the brain was interpreting it as no movement. Rightward movement, this was more, this was less. Now, if this one goes to zero, we all know of so many things. One of them is the resting activity of the hair cell. Resting level also, there is some amount of action potential. But when it is destroyed, those action potentials no longer reach the brainstem. Only from this side, it is reaching the brainstem. So even at rest, this particular number of action potentials reaching the brainstem, even at rest, they're reaching the brainstem, are not being counteracted or cancelled by this brainstem, which works as a comparator, now perceives this as movement. So this is the same situation as the situation here, where head rotation caused increase here, and when brain compares this, right is more than left means rightward rotation. Here also, right is more, though it is the level at which. So that is why a person with unilateral labyrinthine failure, even though he is not moving, he starts getting a perception of movement. This is not there in bilateral labyrinthine failure. In bilateral labyrinthine, both sides go to zero, and therefore there is no net difference. And when brain compares, there is nothing. So he doesn't actually feel a rotational vertigo. Whereas in a unilateral labyrinthine patient, he feels this kind of a rotational vertigo. And I think I have covered the three groups: aberrant stimulation, bilateral labyrinthine failure, and unilateral labyrinthine failure. And most of the peripheral disorders can be placed into one of those things physiologically. As we proceed towards other sessions in this series, you will go into specific disorders and all those things. The job of this one was to give an introduction, and I think thank you all. Dr. Pawan Singhal, to please take over.
Thank you so much, Dr. Srinivas. It was such a wonderful talk about the concepts, core concepts. I think you could clear, like it was like Gagar Mein Sagar.
Thank you.
In a small lecture of maybe an hour, you have included each and everything. I think people would for juniors, for residents, it must have been a bit of difficult thing, but they are open for their questions. I would like to welcome our past president, Dr. Rakesh Kumar, who is senior professor there with Department of ENT at AIIMS, New Delhi. Prahlad sir, can we unmute Rakesh sir?
I am confused. There are two Rakesh Kumar sirs here. I don't know.
Yeah, Rakesh sir, can you see to him? He
No, yes, his picture is not there.
We can unmute both, sir.
Okay. I will unmute
can
both.
Please unmute Dr. Narendra Sugathwara.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can you hear me, Paul?
Yeah.
Yes, we can hear you.
And Dr. Amit Kesri, who is secretary of NES right now.
He is already.
Sugathwara sir is president of NES. Yeah. So the questions are there. I would give this opportunity to the panelists if they do want
Dr. Pawan
to interact with Dr.
Pawan. Sorry to interrupt you. There were two participants who wanted something to be summarized.
Yes.
So can we request Dr. Srinivas to then do that? One way, I think one says that he could understand for the horizontal, what about anterior and posterior canal, this loss of function. And one more question someone was asking before we go on to the other question answer.
There are many questions down there.
No, they wanted that to be revised. You think?
So what specific thing they want to be revised, sir?
I think one wanted that horizontal canal, he could understand when this unilateral loss is happening, what happens.
Yeah.
He wanted to know what if the entire canal.
Subtotal is what I think he wants to know. Okay. Yeah. I think there is a presentation on that. I will just see.
Okay. Then we can skip that.
No, I will show that. But in the meanwhile, you can take the other
correct. Question. Correct.
Okay. Dr. Amit?
Yes, sir.
Would you like to respond to one of the question, which is there from Pradeep Tiwari?
Right.
It says if ENG and VNG is normal, but still patient complains of vertigo. All reports and examinations are normal. So how to proceed with such a patient?
So it can be either we have to take that, is it really a peripheral vestibular disorder?
Yes.
First we have to take the history of migraine, because many a times the symptoms are look like a peripheral vertigo, but they have migraine. The other possibility is some migraine, some vestibular disorder get cured over the time. Okay. But the patient is still feel that he has some giddiness or vertigo. And on that part of it, sometime it is functional. Functional as now postural phobic vertigo. So you should rule out these two things. The one is migraineous vertigo, and the other is postural phobic vertigo. In migraineous vertigo, the patient will have history of migraine or headache in the history. And in postural phobic vertigo, the typical is that when you, even if you give a hand or a finger to the patient feels so much better. And the other thing is that we can do clinically, we can also do the foam test. So we can find out through the foam test that is the problem of the patient, who is what is complaining, how genuine it is. Because the in foam test, you can negate the visual and the proprioception. So the vestibular system is can be tested with more this surety.
Great. I think all the panelists, they agree with Amit to differentiate at first between the central and peripheral vertigo. Akhil sir, you want to add something there?
Only thing is like even the peripheral one, the compensated, if it's long standing, you may not get anything on examination. So probably otherwise also the history is the most important. So the examination and your investigation may not show much. So it is said that old saying that 80% of the time, if you are not clear about the diagnosis by the end of history, it is unlikely that you will get the diagnosis at the end of the examination and the test.
So we do have Dr. Shampa to repeat the peripheral and central core concept. I think we don't have that much time right now to revise the concept. If Dr. Srinivas, would you like to?
The previous question, I have this thing. So for the horizontal canal, it is clear. What about the vertical canals? Okay. So for detailed questions, there are multiple videos that are available on YouTube. You can just hit my name and you will get it. Okay. For a lot of these questions and topics, there are multiple already videos that are available. Okay. And then in the next few days, it will be again answered. Okay. But when it comes to the semicircular canal, so for the right horizontal and the left horizontal, I think it was clear for them. That is what they wanted to know, the directions for the other canals. So this is the ocular motor effects of semicircular canal stimulation. So the right horizontal tries to push the eye to the left, and the left horizontal tries to push the eye to the right. So that is the pushing, means the slow phase. When you look up in nystagmus, it is in the opposite direction of the slow phase. Now I am only talking about the vestibular response, that is the slow phase. The posterior canal, okay, turns the upper lid, upper pole of the eye towards the left and pushes the eye downwards. Whereas the anterior canal again pushes the upper pole of the eye towards the left side and pushes the eye upwards. What happens in dysfunction is, what ocular motor effects of failure of all semicircular canals on one direction. If all semicircular canals on the left fail, what will happen is the sum total of what is left. So down and up, these two things were there. So what will remain? So what will remain is the net effect. So the full thing, this side, whatever was countering this from the opposite side are absent. So nothing to counter the horizontal canal, there is going to be a horizontal component. Nothing to counter these two things, so there is going to be a torsional component. Whereas when it comes to the vertical things, they get cancelled in any case. So they are getting cancelled. That is why what will happen is, in case of unilateral labyrinthine failure, you get a horizontal torsional nystagmus, whereas the vertical component is very minimal. There may be a small upbeating component, but it is not that much. Now, ocular motor effects of failure of superior vestibular nerve. Here, what happens is, you see, If it is superior vestibular nerve, it is the horizontal canal and the anterior canal. When the horizontal canal and anterior canal are destroyed, the net effect of what is remaining, the net effect of what is remaining is this circular is getting cancelled because they are in opposite direction. One remains, so that will come here. Horizontal, there is nothing to cancel the horizontal, so that will come here. And one of these things is cancelled. This up is cancelled by this down, whereas one more down is left. So there is going to be this. So the net is the slow phase of the eye movement will be towards the left ear, which is the ear in which the labyrinthine failure has happened, that is the neuritis has happened, superior vestibular neuritis. The upper pole also, its slow phase turns, that's right. Eye also, slow phase moves downwards. So the fast component will be that you will get a nystagmus beating to the right, that is the intact side. Upper pole beating to the right, that is the intact side. And eye showing a small upward trajectory. So you get these three component mixed nystagmus in this particular patient. So thank you for that question, and I think I answered it.
Dr. Narendra Suratwala, sir, is there?
Yes.
Yes.
Sir, would you like to comment on a question which has been asked by Abdul Wahid? Can vertigo be due to cervical spondylosis?
What losses?
Cervical spondylosis.
Cervical spondylosis itself doesn't give the vertigo or giddiness.
Yeah.
It's always a debatable topic. And you have to find out the root cause and the associated factors along with it. Yeah. There had been the nutritional deficiencies, particularly in females around menopause, who have got calcium and vitamin D deficiencies. So that can cause giddiness. And another thing is that there could be the cervical anomalies along with the basivertebral insufficiency.
Oh,
hello.
So rest of the panelists,
rule out those causes. Yeah. You need to rule out those causes. The cervical spondylosis itself doesn't cause, unless there is a pressure on the vertebral arteries.
Completely agree, sir.
Come. Rakesh sir, want to add something on?
No. It's okay. If someone who is not practicing the neurotology, they say that yes, the cervical vertigo, because they want to push the patient to earth. Otherwise, yes, for the neurotology,
the surgeon wants to push the patient towards physiotherapy or something like that.
Yes, yeah, right.
So there is one interesting question by Dr. Lid Jolly. Can you explain why hangover is there after alcohol?
Yes.
I think Rohit Wal sir has responded
Rohit Wal has correctly said there is basically, you see, that the antidiuretic hormone, the levels of it goes on fluctuating after consuming a good amount of alcohol. And in between phase, there's after passing the urine, the viscosity of the endothelium increases. Now the cupola is like a spring-like structure. When it is pressed, the nerves are excited, and the viscous element is going to keep the pressure on the cupola for a long time. And this long-term action, and as Dorsala has very well explained,
yes,
the deflection of the kinocilia and stegocilia, yes, they're going to stay there for longer time.
So
and that is
more,
why the hangover is there for longer time.
There is one more interesting question from Dr. Kumar Raja. What are the additional measures to improve the success or appease maneuver and prevent the recidivism in benign paroxysmal positional vertigo attacks? Any of the panelists would like to...
Appease maneuver...
Sir, your voice is... Akesh, sir, would you like to answer this question?
Yeah, there is... usually you tell them, beside counseling, that don't extend your head back. That is one. And try avoid sleeping on the side which was affected.
Yes.
So while sleeping, they can put a pillow. And while they are moving around, don't extend the head.
Yeah, these are
some of the
most important practical points, I think.
Sir, I have a point to make. what we tell our patient that when you post procedure, when the patient is in the sitting position, the final position, the head should be down for 30 seconds to let the particle otolith to settle. And the other thing is that if your examination couch is a little higher, the patient can jump onto the ground. I mean, in that way, I learned this technique from Dr. Srinivas, and it is very effective. We just tell patient not to step down, just to take a
jump.
A bit of jump. Yes. And there is always some post-procedural vertigo. And sir says that if it is some vertigo there post-procedural, then you might give vestibular surgery whatever you like for maybe one or two doses, especially if the patient is little vertiginous.
Yes, it was well explained by Rakesh sir and Amit, Dr. Amit. There is one, like Dr. Sonakshi Joshi wanted to ask something about which test on VNG are most helpful to diagnose peripheral vestibular lesions. Tests on VNG. I think she wanted to know about interpretation, I suppose. Somebody would like to take this question?
Can you just repeat the question, sir?
She's asking which tests on VNG are most helpful to diagnose peripheral vestibular lesion in aberrant stimulation.
For that aberrant stimulation, we have some specific. So one, there are again, when it comes to, So when it comes to there are three aberrant stimulations that we dealt with. One was the utricular aberrant stimulation. The other one was the superior canal dehiscence. The other one was benign paroxysmal positional vertigo. So for benign paroxysmal position, we have the positional test for that thing. But I think her question relates to more of utricular function or superior canal dehiscence. When it comes to superior canal dehiscence, we have the tests in VNG called as Valsalva. We can do a Valsalva, both a mouth closed Valsalva and a glottic Valsalva. We also can do Tullio tests. Okay, Tullio test using an audiometer, giving this thing. In fact, in one of the videos, Dr. Sandeep Sharma had presented how he does and how he got in a beautiful nystagmus. Maybe we can refer, show you that video to madam. So that is one thing. Whereas when it comes to utricle itself, that one to the drop attacks, to mimic those drop attacks in the clinic is very difficult. So for that, I don't think we really have any investigation for that matter.
Okay. Then Dr. Veena, she wants to ask about how would congenital vestibular impairment present?
Sir?
How would congenital vestibular impairment present?
Oh, okay. I can open a big presentation out of it. Okay. So, yeah. Again...
Many a time I see, sir, the children having a profound hearing loss. If it is acquired, it is also associated with these problems. And then I typically see the patient spreading the hands while walking, especially the small children. And I also feel, I mean, Srimana sir would be better able to deal with it, that the vestibular system develops slowly over the time. Like when we do cochlear implant for the very small children, we do the same procedure. But when we do the same thing for the adults, adults complain of vertigo more as compared to the children. Children cannot complain, but I don't see them moving their head to the one side, especially in the post. But when children are like 8 to 10 years of age, then they tend to put the head to the other side. And then there are congenital nystagmus also sometimes presenting.
Okay. I think Rakesh sir has got a large series of cochlear implantations to his account. He would have analyzed some vestibular function tests also in cochlear implantees. I think you would have seen, sir, a lot of cases in which like vestibular function affected or maybe impaired preoperatively along with the loss of hearing.
You are right, but I think Dr. Kapil is doing the study.
Yeah.
Clinically, what Dr. Amit says is right. although the adult patient complains of giddiness, children don't complain. But in the beginning, we were thinking why this is happening. Like when the kids, they stop taking by mouth. And they will be like, if going to bathroom, they usually the mother accompanies them, even if the child is like 5 or 6 year old. So probably they both have the problem. But the complaining wise, obviously adult, the post-lingual when you operate, obviously they complain that I'm feeling nausea, I cannot eat, I cannot walk in a straight line. So I think it is both. Probably the kids, they don't complain and they usually take the things better. Like that happens even with the other disease like malignancy. They're always cheerful.
Yeah. So NVK Mohan sir, President-elect has just put in a comment over there that BPPV usually recurs within 3 to 5 years. I think Suratwala sir has got a vast experience of treating these vestibular disorders, maybe 3 decades. Can you comment over that, sir? Suratwala sir?
Yes, in my center, the BPPV, what I used to diagnose in the initial stages was more of a posterior canal. But after the expansion of the knowledge, I am able to diagnose more of the cases of horizontal canal BPP more. Now, as far as the recurrence is concerned, I have not seen recurrence to the tune of worry Dr. Mohan has expressed. But certainly there could be the change of the canal I could see, or sometimes in the horizontal canal, the pathology after recurrence that could show the different side. For example, if I have treated the patient of cupular lithiasis successfully, those patients have come sometimes after 1 year or 2 year with the symptoms of canal lithiasis, which is easily treated with the barbecue maneuver. I have not seen any patient treated by Epler's manure of posterior canal and presenting with some other canal after some time.
Okay.
So that I have not really come across. So recurrences are very, very rare unless the patient gets some traumatic, faces some traumatic incidents after the correction. So that would be a totally different picture. Yeah. Otherwise, recurrence is not common. The success rate, I would suggest to add on, is about 90 to 92% success, whether you are treating posterior canal by Epler's maneuver or horizontal canal. We have got our own modification of Simon's maneuver as well as...
by the experience like yours, a vast experience.
But just to add on, I was really not happy with 90 or 92%.
Yes, sir.
And we always want to achieve best.
As we are short of time... we do have a couple of more questions, like at what age does superior semicircular canal dehiscence presents usually?
Very rare. And so, even the international study.
Amit Khetri wanted to comment on that.
So Indian population, it is very, very rare, sir. But what I have seen that it is not seen, especially it is seen in third and fourth decade after that. But I saw a lot of patients in Europe and US being diagnosed with superior vestibular syndrome. But I mean, I am still to see one patient of, I have maybe seen only one patient of superior vestibular syndrome. Other third window are more common maybe in somewhere else. Due to trauma or due to the
congenital
fistula.
Okay.
I think same experience with us. We, I remember seeing 3 or 4 patients and both were late 40s and
great.
Unlike,
so the consensus is going on towards the fourth decade of life, and it is being very rare in Indian population as such.
Well, someone just to add, there is a let us. Literature I read, the autopsy, a large number of autopsies were done by Gairo-Leinert, and he has said that the incidence on autopsy of superior canal dehiscence was something about 1.8%.
Okay. Yeah. Maybe that is a selection bias. some particular
let me complete my statement. But sir, then
breaking. Can we go ahead? Only a couple of questions because we have already exceeded our time. I think there is one question somebody I wanted to ask, like labyrinthine sedatives about this many times. What
we can take, boss? Yeah. There was a question on downbeat and upbeat nystagmus.
Yeah, you can take that.
Yes. So I think the downbeat nystagmus is not commonly seen in peripheral vestibular disorder. We see mostly in the central vestibular disorder. Sometime I've seen in few congenital cases. So downbeat nystagmus, if you see, then you have to be very careful. The other nystagmus which you have to be careful as a ENT surgeon is direction changing nystagmus. Because if the nystagmus is direction changing, downbeating, only downbeating, not torsional, only downbeating and only upbeating nystagmus are very vary of, like upbeating nystagmus may be there in brainstem lesion, downbeating in sometime in cerebellar lesion. So we have to be careful for all these three type of nystagmus. If it is torsional downbeating, then it's a different phenomena. We have to see that what it is.
Okay, so I would like to share one more thing that we are fortunate enough to have legendaries in balance like Dr. Anirban Vishwas, who has been responding to the queries there on the chat box as well. We do have Dr. Avinash Bizlani, Dr. Sandeep Sharma, who are constantly responding to questions of the PGRs and junior consultants. I think it has been a great session, Dr. Srinivas. You deserve a great, like a big round of applause. And I think all the panelists, they have justified their questions. Sorry, we could not take all the questions as such, but you guys can put it there on the Facebook link on Aristica Orient. So we can respond there on the Facebook itself, or maybe then the subsequent sessions. These webinars will go on every Tuesday and Friday, 7:30 to 9 p.m. with the same login ID and the password. So thank you so much, Rakesh sir. Rakesh sir has been very kind enough to, like, because out of his busy schedule, he could get some time for the webinar. He was past president NES, and during his tenure, we have developed a lot of new things. Dr. Amit is there, who was immediate past president. Amit Kesari, I would like to request you to give a concluding remark.
So I would like to, yes. So on the behalf of NES, I would like to thank all the participants for logging in, and Dr. Pralas sir for all the tech support for today. He is very helpful to us to conduct this webinar, and I thank you all the panelists, including our president and the past president and the past secretary, Dr. Mohan Singhal, and hope that we continue the same zeal and enthusiasm in the next sessions to come. So there were many questions who pertain to a particular disorder. When we will cover that particular disorder, we will be addressing more questions in that.
We can respond them on Facebook. Yes. No issue there.
I have a small request to the
okay.
President.
Thank you.
Yes.
I have a small request to President Secretary. If possible, please issue a e-certificate at the end of the course for participants who attend all the programs.
Certainly, sir.
Certainly,
there is a condition. Yeah. We should attend all the programs.
Yes, all the programs.
Yes.
It will be mailed to them.
Yeah. That's better. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, there are some automatic certificate generation systems. I will tell you how to do that. We can do that. Okay. And also, you should announce next program. Who's the next speaker, if possible, before you end the program.
So next, I can share my screen there.
Yeah. Next program, next class, who will be there? What's the topic?
So I'll give them a brief idea of the things.
Share the PPT.
So I made a table out of it. So the thing is, this was the first show. The second one would be, I think, more important and interesting. Dr. Avinash Bizlani, with his all energy and ecos, is going to deal with history taking and examination part. And Dr. Amit Kesri will be moderating the session there. Yeah, then we will have Shikhar Malik.
One more suggestion. If any particular topic, if the speaker or the participant feel that the time was not sufficient, maybe we should have one more class at the end of the session or something, you know, sometime later.
I think we need to give more time to Srinivas. So there have been a lot of queries, and I think they wanted to repeat the things. So what we can have an extra session of half an hour or maybe 1 hour.
Sometime later once we finish everything. Yeah.
So there would be repetition of the things, revision of the things rather.
And sir, I think Srinivas sir, videos are there in YouTube, and all attendees can go there, and he has very detailed explanation of things. So we can do an extra lecture also, and in the meantime we will encourage participant to go, because he has recorded videos in his previous lecture, and that's are already available on the YouTube.
So we do have in our the further lectures, we have got so many dignitaries are there. Taglapur Gans is there. Pralas sir is going to deliver lecture on differential diagnosis in a very easy way. He had delivered an oration in MES. Anita Mandari ma'am, who is doing good job with pharmacotherapy, would be coming. Richard Gans is there for vestibular rehabilitation. Nobody can better explain rehabs than him. Then Amit, with his own studies of Meniere's disease, we have got Vishal Pawar from Dubai, who is enthusiastic neurologist. He will get us some insight into the neurological causes and with the case-based discussion. Then we have Surat Pala sir, the president himself, enlightening on atherosclerosis. And we do have some good surgeons who are well-known surgeons. One, Dr. Sampath is there. He will be telling us about all the surgeries which we could do for vertigo. And one and only Satish Jain would be there to tell us about all the anatomical aspects of the lateral skull base as well as the inner ear. So I think that is going to be interesting in the coming sessions. Meanwhile, we can, I think,
end the meeting. Session. Yes, yeah. Thank you very much to all the speakers and all the participants.
Good beginning is half done.
Thank you, Arun.
Thank you, Dr. Pawan. And thank you, Narendra, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. And especially the NES team, which
thank
is
taking. Thank you, everybody, for a grand response. I think, very good number of participants. I think probably 350-400.
I'll give you a good news. 404 participants from 22 countries.
Thank you, Prahlad. Thank you very much on behalf of NES, on everybody. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Okay.
Thank you.
Bye. Good night.
Bye.
Good night, sir. Good night.
You can give inputs on WhatsApp also on NES, or maybe you can call to us. You can put it on Facebook. Anybody of us, you can call and tell us the problems or the queries or the improvisation tactics. If you want something to be improved in OER, we can do that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Pawan, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Good night, all.
Good night.